Welcome to those online and those in the room to the productivity in America. My name is Lourdes Casanova. I'm the director of the Emerging Markets Institute at Cornell University. Productivity has been kind of a holy grail of Latin America. Many reports show us that the productivity increases in Latin America have not been great in the last 15 years, even during the golden decade. Often we link productivity to low labor cost, but if we dig into data from Mexico, we see that in spite of the low labor cost of Mexico, Mexico does not compete that well with China. In the face facing the fourth industrial revolution, the question is which type of development policies governments can implement to increase productivity. We are going to start with Fabian Hill to my right, who is in Dow Chemical Latin America, and will give us his perspective from the private sector.
Thank you, Lourdes, and thanks for the opportunity to share with all of you a little bit of our vision from the private sector standpoint. Representing more than 7,000 employees in Latin America, we have been here for 60 years, but also a good network of customers and local companies from every size that do business with us for many, many years. One of the of the things that I'd like to start sharing with you is in our vision, of course, our activity demands a lot of capital and investments, and usually we don't look at countries only for the GDP or for the inflation. We try to look also at business conditions that are created in the countries to invest. And Latin America has a huge potential, as we all know. We have it is a region with a lot of natural resources and human capital. We know that we have opportunities, and we are passionate about the growth opportunities that we have in the region, particularly on the energy side, on the opportunities around food security, also infrastructure, and the new consumer habits. So it's our passion to bring technology to the communities in the way of business. But the conditions in which countries create for companies like Dow to invest are becoming more and more critical. The globalization of the supply chains, the globalization of the value chains are making that countries for companies like us compete to each other. So where do we put the money is basically also basic on the conditions that the country provides long term. We believe that for Latin America has a big opportunity to transform itself. And for us, the big engine for doing that is what we call the manufacturing sector. I mean, we have been working with a concept which is the advanced manufacturing programs in many countries around the world. We are starting to work this in Latin America. This is a great opportunity to develop long-term plans for Dow and other companies. It's a way of looking at market opportunities in ways of value chain, in which not only big companies, but small companies, local companies can work together with public sector to develop strategically where are those opportunities. We have a lot of natural resources. The question is, what do we do with them? And now for companies like Dow, these manufacturing advanced plans are becoming key to decide where the money is going. So it's a key factor for investment. On the ask side, when we look at these long-term plans and we look at opportunities, we have a few basic principles that I think affect the productivity, if you want, and the decision for investment. The one thing for us is key decisions on energy policy, right? Our region has a lot of resources. We are sitting here in Argentina and the second or third largest reserve of shale gas in the world. This is really huge. But the question is, what do we do with that? Right? Do we explore gas? Do we explore hydrocarbons only just to burn fuel or to export fuel? Or do we something with it? And that's the power of this advanced manufacturing concept. We can start adding rings of manufacturing, starting from the building blocks of the natural resources all the way down to very complex value chains with high value that can really drive growth, jobs, and opportunities for companies, right? So for us, energy policy is key. The second principle, if you want, in these plans is to have a good tax system. I mean, tax is becoming a key issue for us in the region. We have countries in the region where we need to put three times the amount of resource in compared to other countries just to administer the tax system. Right? So tax is something that we really need to make things happen. The other thing is to have a smart regulatory framework. We want to have regulatory frameworks that can be transparent, that can be based on science, that can be efficient, and that can be predictable also, because things change a lot. And this is also part of how the business are perceived in a country. Excuse me. The other thing that is important to point out in this principle is to address the issue of future skills. As we develop these rings of manufacturing based on natural resources, it's obvious that we need more engineers, we need more mathematicians, we need science. The whole thing around the STEM discussion, we need to start working on STEM education, because for sure, if we fulfill this vision of creating all this manufacturing in a region like this, the first thing that we will need to know is more people, more qualified people. So education is going to be key for us. And everything is also based on free trade. Free trade is like a magnet for capital. And free trade creates true long-term competitiveness for a country, regardless ideology, regardless of the specific policy of a given government. It's a long-term competitiveness that affects productivity. The last one, I'm sorry taking all this time, is I think in all this discussion that we're having, like forums like here, Mercosur, where governments are discussing policies, is to be sure that businesses have a seat on the table. Because we are working in those long-term plans, we know what buttons need to be pushed to unblock the opportunities for growth, and we can help a lot with our vision. Again, we are very excited about the future of Latin America. If we can solve these four or five issues that I just mentioned briefly, I think the opportunities are tremendous.
Thank you, Fabian. Ricardo Haneine from ATT Kearney, you have been studying this very complex issue of productivity, and now we are facing a new era in terms of free trade. The new U.S. administration has been quite confrontational with respect to Mexico and NAFTA, and one of the most successful value chains was the automotive industry between Mexico and the U.S. How do you see that in your studies about productivity, and how do you see the future after this new U.S. administration?
Well, what we think is that NAFTA needs to be modernized, but it needs to be modernized based on the business and economic trends, which really are related to some of the aspects of the fourth industrial revolution, like the digitization, labor, environment. But if you follow a protectionist approach to modernizing NAFTA, I think that will have destroying consequences for the three countries, for Mexico, for the US, and for Canada. And both will lose in terms of Mexico and the US, where the trade it's more important, where Mexico has like more than 75% of its trade, and the US exports to Mexico more than 45% of its trade. Our estimates is that for every 10 percentage points that you increase the effective tariffs, we'll lose around 0.5% of GDP and around 64,000 jobs. So that will have an impact either in cost to consumers of the region, and we would be displaced by other countries, specifically China. And that puts the regional competitiveness at stake. The US has a trade deficit of 3% of its GDP. Of that 3%, Mexico has around 8% superavit. That's the deficit of that 3%, 8% corresponds to Mexico, and 47% corresponds to China. And that has been fairly steady, and the analysts do not expect that might change. So the approach should be, let's modernize NAFTA and not try to be protectionist, because then China will really get deeper into the region, instead of having a very strong region when we have a lot of complementarity with a global with a global supply chain. For example, the investment, the foreign direct investment of the US in Mexico since 1990 has been around $250 billion. And that foreign direct investment has really transformed into exports to the US. So what's the issue? How does it relate to productivity? Mexico has modernized basically with NAFTA in some of its sectors. Mexico has three main sectors that exports like around 80% of it's basically automotive, electric and electronics and machinery. And we have others like aerospace that have been growing in a very important way. So it would really hurt Mexico and the US. And are we happy with the level of productivity that we have? Are we happy with how we have modernized those sectors? And we feel that we're really concentrating in a very small part of the Mexican economy. Manufacturing for Mexico represents around 17% of GDP. And for example, the automotive sector, if you see the whole value chain, it represents around 5% of GDP. When we're a very important world producer, so how can we increase productivity and value added in a sector that really has a lot of presence? We're importing a lot, but how do we do the right investments, as Fabian was saying, the right investments to really participate more in engineering and design, in more smart manufacturing, where we can really add much more value. And instead of having around 5% of GDP, that sector can really transform into an 8 to 10% of GDP. And we're talking only about 17% in terms of manufacturing. But if you see the service sector that represents around 63% of the economy, we need to talk in terms of this bulk of how to increase productivity in those sectors. Government, all this digital transformation in government has to really happen much deeper and much faster. Telecommunications, financial sector, and all the SMEs that are around service and that are with very low levels of productivity and that hire and employ more than 70%, we need to create an ecosystem that really fosters that type of innovation so that we can have small companies become medium and medium become large, but they have been fairly steady. So I think productivity, we have a huge gap, but we have a lot of the elements that we can control internally in terms of training and retraining with our demographic boom so that people can really adapt and adjust, and not only in the automotive sector. And you said something that China beats Mexico, not in the automotive sector. That's the only sector where Mexico has really been the leader in terms of the global supply chains linked to the US.
Good news from Latin America, good news from Mexico. We need more of those to have good benchmarking that we can follow. So great news. And also Mexico has very good engineers, and the percentage of graduates who are engineers is quite high compared to the rest of the region and very close to the OECD levels, which is, of course, you have the talent needed to be in more value-added sectors.
And we need more, because if you compare the technology and the design centers in Mexico relative to China, I think that's why a lot of those centers have been going to China, to India. I think if we have more than the other country in Latin America, I think we have a lot of potential to really continue building on that and to bring back a lot of the Mexican engineers that have outstanding positions in global companies.
So let me just turn to Ricardo Hausmann from Harvard. Ricardo has been an early promoter of the need for countries to diversify their economies. And of course, Latin America, as we know, has been too dependent of commodities. So how, and of course, this is a very important part of productivity and growth. So to sustain growth, Ricardo has always said, we need economies that are diversified, that they are not dependent on one sector.
So let me respond a little to the discussion. I think to increase productivity, you have to increase the average productivity of workers. And the average productivity of workers is a sum of the productivity of each worker. And when you look at Latin America, there's an enormous dispersion in productivities. Enormous dispersion of productivities. You're talking about the productivity at the super right side edge of the productivity distribution. And there, you know, Latin American productivity growth has been okay. The only thing is that that productivity has been growing so much that that sector in terms of employment has even been shrinking. In a study we did of Mexico, we found, you know, that the productivity differences between a state of Chiapas or Guerrero and a state of Nuevo León is something like a factor of 8. That means that Chiapas is more or less like at Honduras levels and Nuevo León is at Korean levels. So with the same sort of energy policy, tax policy, this policy and that policy, you are having these enormous differences in productivity. One way for Mexico to increase its productivity is for having Chiapas and Nuevo and Guerrero emulate the productivities of Nuevo León. So the question is, how do you do that? In a study we've done on Bogotá, we ask ourselves, you know, why is the informal sector so large in Latin America? Why are there so many people self-employed in activities that are very low productivity? Well, part of the answer is that Latin Americans face the highest commute costs in the world, that we have designed cities that are really unlivable, where people have to live very, very far away, connected by very lousy urban transport. So people are faced with the choice of going to work, spending 2 hours in the attempt to go to work, 2 hours coming back, and more than 2 hours of salary in the process. So it's like they're 12 hours out of home. They collect 8 minus 2 is 6. So it's like a 50% tax on going to work before you start paying payroll taxes. So we have to have more productive cities. In a study we did on Panama, as you know, it's the fastest growing country in Latin America for the last 25 years, for the last 10 years, because they have really developed an ecosystem to support service exports. And they are at the peak of, you know, foreign direct investment into the region. Part of the secret of why Panama has grown so much is that by Latin American standards, they have a relatively open immigration policy. By Canadian standards or by Australian standards, they have a disastrous immigration policy. But by Latin America's disastrous immigration policies, they are fairly good at. And we have done studies to show that the productivity of the locals is dramatically increased when they work with foreigners. So in the case of Mexico, for example, there is one foreigner for every 250 people. In Singapore, 40% of the people are foreigners. In Canada, 25% of the people are foreigners. In Colombia, 0.25% of the people are foreigners. There is one foreigner in 400 people. So that also limits the ability to mix your skills with other people's skills. So what I would like to put on the table is that part of the problem of Latin America, low productivity, and part of the high inequality in Latin America is due to an enormous inequality in productivity. It's not that the pies are being shared in the wrong way between capital and labor. It's that in different parts of the country, in different parts of the city, people are baking cakes of radically different sizes. And if we really want to talk about improving productivity in Latin America, we have to include people, incorporate people into activities of much higher productivity.
Thank you. Philippe Leueru, as CEO of IFC, you were in Colombia while I was there last week, and you announced that IFC was going to invest $4 billion in the next 5 years in Colombia. Infrastructure, as Ricardo just said, is a very important part of the equation of increasing productivity and increasing growth. What are your plans for Colombia, and how do you see the region?
Well, thank you. And first of all, I'd like to say that I completely agree with what Mr. Gill said. I mean, he kind of laid out really the key being building blocks that you need to, and productivity is a resultant, obviously. One of the, so I'd maybe zoom in on two, is, and Ricardo mentioned of that too, the inter-regional trade. I worked for a long time in Eastern Europe, so I compare to Eastern Europe, Latin America, more or less the same level of kind of middle income, But the trade, the inter-regional trade in Latin America is very low. I mean, I saw 20%. It's 50% in ECA. So, I mean, there's a huge way to go. Linked to that, and look to what Ricardo was saying, is I saw statistics talking about Colombia. To send whatever, a container from Bogota to the coast, Atlantic coast, cost 40% more than from the coast to Shanghai. So, yeah, intra-city, but across country. I mean, it's. I mean, how do you want to fight such a disadvantage? So, in IFC, we decided to. It's a new push on the, on our strategy is to try to go much more strongly in the infrastructure space, because what we see is in many countries there's no fiscal space. Not only there's not enough fiscal space, but it's reducing for macro reasons that in many countries are obvious, because you need some stability on the macro side as a precondition for investment. We all understand that. The problem is that how do you bring private finance to finance ports, airports, but also roads? What really fascinated me in Colombia 2 days ago was a discussion about what we call the 4G program, yeah. Fourth generation. It's why it's fourth generation. It's a fourth generation of PPPs. Now, public-private partnership, a lot of people like them, especially in the Ministry of Finance, because it's a way to crowd in private finance. However, to do it right is very difficult. You need the legal framework, the documentation to make sure you're at scale, and you need a local currency solution for long term. So you need a capital market. So I think that we have worked to the first generation in Colombia. We have improved, same here, by the way, in Argentina. We are very happy with the, we have worked with the, our colleagues in the World Bank to and the government to put this new PPP framework. I think that is a lot of promise. And the Renovar program, I think it's a very good example for wind, I mean, renewable, but essentially wind energy. And that's good, that's one pillar. But you need to develop the other pillar, which is a deeper capital market. Because financing in dollars, infrastructure that will give you local currency revenue, it's an issue. So we are working in Colombia very very closely with the government to deepen the capital markets. So we'll have more and more of this type of solutions, because even the swap market, you cannot rely on that. So we cannot swap easily. So, and here in Argentina, I think that we have to follow the same path. So this is one slice, if you want, of the bigger or huge productivity issue. But connectivity, logistics, hence infrastructure is critical. We believe that the role of the private sector can be multiplied not by a percentage, but by a factor in the in this area. I think that we have made a lot of progress through trial and error on PPPs. And the PPP is not something you go to university, there's a book on it, and you just apply it. It's a lot of trial and error. And I think that we have matured, and we are in a very nice place. So that's on the PPP framework, if you want, and capacity of a government to implement this this framework. The next challenge is deepen the capital market. I would like to be involved in that. And again, if you think about what is IFC and what is even, I will go beyond that, the whole World Bank Group, I called it in London recently, we are just a huge de-risking machine. And it's a, it's all about de-risking. We just floated a new instrument to crowd in private finance in the infrastructure realm. We call it the MCPP, but the idea is very simple. We approach insurance companies, big ones, Allianz, we're talking yesterday with Swiss Re, AXA. They are sitting on billions of dollars. So the point is how, what kind of investment you put for the long run. So what we did is we told them, listen, in IFC, we invest in all emerging markets. So why don't you take a slice of the portfolio automatically? And But that was a problem because they had not the risk appetite to go through their boards. You had to have triple B. I mean, I don't want to go too technical. So we told them, fine, because the returns can be much better than, you know, a treasury bond bund in Germany for 20 years, which is not very profitable. So the return they liked, but they didn't like the risk. So what we did is, okay, we'll give you a first loss guarantee. Now, this first loss guarantee, 10%. Enable to reduce the risk and increase the risk to about a triple B equivalent. But then we went even further because I didn't like to have that on my balance sheet. So you can turn around and have part of this 10% first loss given to ODA, to in this case it was a Swedish development company, because it's very interesting. So you de-risk, and that's maybe a new way to utilize development finance. So we're trying to explore, based on the infrastructure, so it's all linked, infrastructure needs, lack of fiscal space. How do we find private solution to attract these huge pools of capital foreign? We need also the local side. And we are starting to find new, very interesting instruments, which will enable to completely rethink the development finance as we know it.
Thank you. And now we turn to the governor of the Central Bank of Argentina, Federico Sturzenegger. What are your views to increase growth and increase productivity? And we can talk a little bit of Argentina. My taxi driver, when I came from the airport, said, how are things? Said, oh, we have a lot of hope. That's good news. Next semester.
With a general comment and then talk about the challenges for productivity in Argentina. And the general comment goes back to an academic paper, which I think was very interesting, written a couple of years ago, which is called Economic Growth from 1 Million Before Christ Until Today by a Harvard professor called Michael Kremer. And what he finds in that paper is that the rate of growth of per capita income at the world level is proportional to the population of the world. So let me repeat, because so we understand it. This means that as the world becomes bigger, as the population becomes bigger, the rate of growth of per capita income grows. So this is kind of, the world is becoming bigger, and as it becomes bigger, it grows faster. And the Kremer's explanation, which ties to the trade issue that you were discussing before, has to do with the fact of the incentives to innovation. Mm-hmm. If you're going to develop the digital camera, kind of moving from the what we had before, and you have a market of 5 million people, it's much more different if you have a market of 5 billion people to which you're going to sell this thing. So as the world has become bigger, the incentives to innovation have become larger, the incentives for productivity change have become larger, and that's the reason the world grows faster and faster. So if you think of what's the only relevant thing or the most relevant thing that happened in the world over the last 20 years is basically that you've incorporated China and India to the world market. So suddenly the world has become much bigger. So if this logic, which held from 1 million before Christ until today, continues to hold for the next 20 years, that means that we're moving into perhaps the 20 or 30 future years of highest growth the world has ever seen. So that's kind of a first tone. I think the productivity agenda is going to become increasingly important, and it's increasingly fast, and it's going to surprise us in a way that we don't anticipate. I always tell the story that my 11-year-old kid, when he was 7, he watched TV. But my current 7-year-old daughter doesn't know what TV is. She just looks at YouTube and Netflix and on her iPad. So it's a very different world. Now, that means that the incentives to innovation are related to the size of the market you target. And in Argentina, for example, we have an example, which is the agricultural sector, which is a sector which has really kind of always built with a view, a kind of looking to the world as its market. Well, in Argentina, you have the tractors are self-driven. The agriculture, the farmers check their crops with drones. So you have really a very thriving and very innovative and very productive environment. So I think that the relationship between innovation and trade is there, and it's very strong, it's very important. This is going to be a very important part of the agenda that Argentina is going to push in its presidency of G20 next year. Now let me go to the, so I have a very positive and very optimistic view of the world going forward. Let me talk about the challenges for Argentina, because then you have to come down and each country has to see, okay, how do you actually profit from these great opportunities that the world is going to give? And I'm actually going to run through the same things that you mentioned, because really there's nothing new there, but for example, human capital. If you look at the competitive index of the World Economic Forum, you see that Argentina, one of its strengths is human capital. Mm-hmm. And for example, engineers, you were mentioning engineers. Well, I'm sure you'll get the Fordow, the best engineers in Argentina, and they'll eventually be all around the world working for Fordow. So we have a very good human capital at that level. But at the same time, we have a huge challenge because today, for example, half of our kids don't finish high school. So those who go through actually become among the best professionals, engineers in the world, but we have a really significant challenge at the level of our country. Then the other thing is physical capital. Huge challenge for Argentina. We have a financial sector which is 15% of GDP. I'm sure that those of us who visit from other countries, they won't believe what I'm saying. 15. So this is one-third, one-sixth of the financial sectors in another country. Now, why did this happen in Argentina? Well, because we never protected the depositor in the financial sector. Financial repression, negative interest rates, people didn't save in the financial sector. We don't have Argentina's savings intermediated through the financial sector. We have to change this radically. We have Argentinians having $400 billion saved abroad, which we need to be intermediated through the financial sector. So that's, I think we have a big challenge. Infrastructure is, I think, another chapter, which IFC obviously helps a lot. We're auctioning off road construction around half the price that the previous government did. So transparent procurement is very important. But the most important thing, for example, if you take road construction, is to do the roads where there are cars. And sorry, this is not a joke, okay? If you build roads where there are no cars, the productivity is very shallow, okay? So just bring that money to where you have cars, increase the productivity 100 times, 1,000 times, you name it. I mean, it's kind of, so I think there's a very significant role there. The other thing that affects government, of course, then Ricardo told us that all this is wrong, but I'll get back to that in a second. But the government efficiency, you talked about taxes, no? And I think three simple principles that you should have about taxes. Taxes should be as low as possible, they should be as simple as possible, and they should be paid. Yes. Okay, so those are the three things, and that's the way you should think about your tax structure. And that, but efficient government is what is going to allow you to reduce the tax burden. So it's using the resources. I tend, when they ask me about the current government, say, having worked with President Macri for the last 10 years, I always tell everybody, go and look at what this person did in his tenure while he was a mayor of the city of Buenos Aires if you want to see a huge improvement in the quality of public services and efficiency in government, where you had a government which started providing many, many more services at a lower cost. And that is feeds directly into efficiency, no? And then the big combo where I fit, which is where the central bank fits, which is rules, no? And this is the game. And sometimes more important than what the rules are, knowing that the rules are stable. So you can say, okay, these are the rules I operate with, and then I know what so it's all the legal framework and the judicial framework, and which is very important. But then you have, and this for Argentina is much more important than for other Latin American countries, because you've already solved this problem, which is the macro stability framework. You need to have a macro which is stable. So you have to have fiscal sustainability, and you have to have low inflation, which is my agenda, or my responsibility, I should say. And here that the lowering of inflation is, it kind of touches on three issues, and with this I finish. First, there's an equity issue. Inflation is a tax. And it's a tax that's paid by the poor. So the lowering of the inflation has something that perhaps is a little bit is a little bit absent from the debate. I see some Argentinian journalists here, so that's why I'm emphasizing this. Absent from the debate, the fact that when you lower inflation, you have a tremendous past and a tremendous improvement in equity because you're reducing the tax that's paid by the poorest in the population. Now, the other thing is, for example, we've done a study of countries which have crossed the 20% annual inflation rate, which is where Argentina is right now, in a sustainable manner, doubled their growth rates in the following 10 years. So you have the growth agenda at the same time. And the third thing is that the reason that low inflation feeds into directly into productivity is when you have high inflation, the markets don't work. People don't know what prices are. You have a lot of instability. You have to take a lot of insurances. You shorten the horizons of your investment and saving decisions. So kind of everything kind of starts working in a much less orderly fashion. So we believe, and I think President Macri also mentioned this yesterday, we don't see any trade-off between growth and inflation in Argentina. Maybe you have that trade-off in a low inflation country. Maybe you go to Chile or you go to Peru or you go to Colombia and maybe you have that trade. You don't have that trade-off here. Because the growth effect and the equity effect of lowering inflation is so strong that that's why it has to be first in the public agenda. So, but public agenda, both in equity, but both in productivity and therefore in growth.
So will be next semester?
No, last semester, because inflation in the last semester of last year already fell to a third of what it had been in the first half of the year. The thing is that, of course, you know, in Argentina, never a dull moment here. You have these tariffs come down, then tariffs go up, so it was a little bit choppy throughout the semester. That's why people didn't perceive how much inflation had really declined last semester.
So also another thing regarding the peso, I was really shocked when I say 15 pesos to the dollar. Uh-huh. So how do you combine, in a moment in which all currencies in Latin America, Mexico, Colombia, and of course Argentina, and Brazil, of course, the currency is very low. So this combination of very low currencies, that then because the whole region has very low currency with respect to the dollar, so the competitive advantage disappears. Inflation and debt in dollars, so Argentina has been quite aggressive in issuing bonds in dollars. So how do you see all this combination looking forward?
Yeah, look, we decided to stop improvising. So we saw what Colombia did, we saw what Mexico did, we saw what the UK did, what Chile did, what Canada did, what Australia did. And small open economies like Argentina, which want to be integrated in the world, they have decided that the best macroeconomic framework is to have an inflation targeting regime with floating exchange rates. With floating exchange rates. And that's what we have implemented, and that's the way it has been operating. We have virtually not intervened in the foreign exchange rate market for the last 8 months. We have built up a little bit of our reserves. We've bought about $17 billion in reserves because we started from a very low level of reserves, and we think Argentina needs that kind of a bit more insurance on that side. But we have basically not intervened in the. Now the real exchange rate today, the real effective multilateral real exchange rate today is 30% more depreciated than it was before we released the exchange rate controls at the end of 2015. So 13, now people may say that's too much, some people may say that's too little, that's where the market has it today. Very stable real exchange rate. This, I mention this sometimes to people and they're surprised. The real exchange rate over the last 8 months has been very stable, very stable. Maybe most of 4 or 5% overall change over the last 8 months without any clear trend in one way or the other. You have to be careful. In Argentina, they pay a lot of attention to the relationship between the peso and the dollar. But it can very well happen that over the last semester, we had a lot of changes in the dollar. Mm. So, for example, the peso can depreciate vis-a-vis the dollar, but if at the same time the real is depreciating and the Mexican peso is depreciating or the euro is depreciating, then you have no depreciation in the real exchange rate. And then this year you've had a sharp appreciation, but at the same time that the real was appreciating, the euro was appreciating, the Mexican peso, well, was the one who appreciated most, and therefore you don't have a movement in the real exchange rate. In fact, the stability of the real exchange rate, it is what shows that the exchange rate is really floating. So sometimes, I mean, we have to be, just to start with the numbers, and what we think is good about the floating exchange rate is that it allows the economy to have a shock absorber, and we're not using the exchange rate as an anchor for anything. I've said this many times. So if the exchange rate, the only thing we focus in terms of our monetary policy is inflation. So if the exchange rate needs, everybody thinks, okay, the exchange rate is cheap, well, then I guess someone will buy it, and then it would depreciate, and vice versa. So, but again, we're not making up anything. We're just copying a model that served very well all these emerging economies. And I think it's time for Argentina to do what everybody has shown that it works.
Thank you very much. Let's open the discussion to the public. Please be brief and identify yourself.
Yeah. Hello, this is Valentin Schmidt with the Epoch Times from New York. Now, Mr. Sturzenegger, you mentioned that lowering inflation is good for equality, productivity, and growth, and I think everybody would agree. But how exactly is the central bank going to lower inflation with the money supply year over year is still up about 30-40%? What are the exact measures you're going to implement to reach your target? Thank you.
Okay, why don't we take 3-4 questions and then we answer. Any other questions?
Yes, yes, good. My name is Julio Estrada. I'm from Guatemala. In the write-up or the session summary, there is some ideas about using fourth industrial revolution tools for increasing productivity. And I wonder if any of the participants, maybe Dr. Hausmann or Mr. Haneine or even the moderator, has some ideas of how that fourth industrial revolution, how is there chances to leapfrog? Should we have a lot of uneducated people who will remain uneducated for a long time, and even the one we educate will be educated in about 15 or 20 years. So if we have a fourth industrial revolution, is there anything we should take into account just to create jobs, productivity, and just leap a generation? Is there a chance to just avoid a complete third revolution? Because in some of our countries, we haven't gone through the third revolution, industrial revolution. So if any ideas there, we're very open and eager to hear them.
Excellent questions. A third one?
One in the back.
Behind?
In the back.
Yeah.
Marcos from Brazil. My question is to Mr. Ricardo Hausmann. If you were a president of a country like Brazil or Argentina, how would you develop a new generation of industrial policy?
That's a very good one. Okay, excellent questions. Let's start by the governor of the Central Bank of Argentina.
Okay, let me start. Again, as I said, we don't want to invent anything, and inflation targeting regimes in terms of its management of monetary policy is pretty standard. You choose a policy instrument, which in our case is the interest rate. If inflation comes down, the interest rate comes down. If inflation goes up, the interest rate goes up. That's it. Simple. Everyone understands it. You tighten monetary conditions if inflation comes up, and you release monetary conditions if inflation comes down. Last year, of course, we were coming out of the unification of the exchange rate market. The government had also set a program of very significant adjustment in utility prices. We brought the interest rate up to 38%. We said we were not going to move it until we saw inflation coming down, which started happening 3 months afterwards. As inflation came down, as I already mentioned, in the second half of the year, the inflation came down to a third what it had been, for example, in the City of Buenos Aires index, a third of what it had been in the first half of the year. So the nominal interest rate started coming down. We had very good numbers in December and January. We ended the second half with the lowest inflation in 8 years. The numbers in February, the government again started like a second round of utility price adjustments. So the number in February came, the general level came up a little bit. And the number that we saw in March basically convinced us that we had to do a tightening of monetary policies, which we have already done. So we have already done a tightening over the last month in the longer part of our yield curve with an increase of about 200 basis points in our interest rate. And of course, this is an ongoing debate. Having an inflation targeting regime doesn't mean, oh, I say I want to have a 12-17%. Look at the number we have. So we're still very high inflation, no? So 12-17, that's the modest objective that we have for this year. And it's not say, oh, I do that, and then I pray to see what happens. No, no. Inflation targeting means that you have to act to have that happen, and you use it adjusting monetary policy conditions. We have already done that in March, and this is an ongoing exercise that the central bank does permanently, and it builds its credibility by acting in a consistent way with its mandate and the objective that it has set for itself. So again, nothing new under the sun. The only thing is that as time goes by, we try to be consistent, we try to be coherent, we try to act accordingly to what we say, and we hope that will strengthen credibility over time. These are not things that you build from one day to the next. One comment here. One of the big agendas we have is financial inclusion. Mm-hmm. And boy, when you were mentioning, we have a lot of uneducated people, so how do they jump to the fourth generation revolution? But the ability of these people sometimes in the lower income levels or where there is lesser education, their embracing of technology sometimes surprises you. Mm-hmm. I was president of a commercial bank, a state-owned commercial bank, before becoming governor, and I set up the first branch in a shanty town. So we set up a branch in a shanty town, and we did it. It didn't have human cashiers. It was a totally technological branch. And once I went into the branch, and there was someone trying to do an operation on the machine, and someone from the shanty, I said, no, you're doing it wrong. It has to be done this way. And he looked at me like saying, you don't understand anything. No, guy, it's done this way. Pa, 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 pa. And he kind of got things done. So careful. I mean, I think there's a lot of potential there, perhaps in the most surprising places.
I would request the rest of the panel members to also answer this question.
Yeah,
because
the difficult balance
between job reduction, as it has happened in the US, that most of the jobs have been reduced not because of free trade, but because of technology, of robotization, etc. So how do you balance the need to create more jobs in Latin America, mainly in the poorer countries, in all of them, with the technological revolution, with the fourth industrial revolution? Maybe we can...
Yeah, let me just say, the Latin American countries, in terms of their productivity and GDP per capita, are between 5% and 30-35% of the U.S. How do you, we have talked about physical infrastructure, human capital, how do you go to the technological part? I think the third industrial revolution, which we are still behind, what we really need is more investment to really deep the penetration of internet users, broadband penetration, mobile subscribers, and basically Chile and Brazil are the highest, but all the other countries are really behind. Now, in terms of the duality of how do you go to the fourth industrial revolution, I think a lot of the investments that are taking place are in the manufacturing sector, in automotive, electric, electronics, in aerospace. What we've seen is a lot of those investments are really the companies, the large corporations that are really participating in the global trade are really investing a lot in the new future of production in terms of how do you incorporate and change your whole business model to introduce advanced robotics, to introduce artificial intelligence, to introduce Internet of Things. That would really create a displacement of the current way you employ because we're changing completely the way the production takes place in terms of physical places and how you design your whole business model. But you cannot say exactly what will happen, but there's a lot of investment taking place and that we're seeing from the large OEMs and for the large tier one companies. So as long as someone was saying, if you need to have open economies to really integrate the fourth industrial revolution, because if not, you cannot do it if you do not consider a global supply chain. So I think as long as you are really integrated globally in a global supply chain, you will really take advantage of these three or four types of new technologies that are taking place in the fourth industrial revolution.
Thank you.
Lourdes, first to your question, it's interesting because when we look at these advanced manufacturing plans we put together, what is the first thing that comes out of these plans? The need or the opportunity for more companies. So when you start building in this complex value chain throughout the value chains, it's automatically more jobs. Mm-hmm. So if you have this advanced manufacturing view, jobs will come. And to build on yours, it's a very interesting question about your fourth generation. I'll give you a couple of things that to build on your give different perspective. Productivity, for example, if you take beef production in Latin America, with the technology that we already have today, it just we use the technology and we increase productivity to half of what US has as productivity to produce beef, the region can release an equivalent of land, equivalent to the size of the country of Costa Rica. 1/3 of the food in a region which has a high level of poverty is wasted. 1/3. All from farming to consumers. But you know what? The technology to fix all that is available and it's affordable. So just by using what we have in our hands, next Monday, we can still fix in issues of productivity that can really bring a lot of value to the region. I'm not saying that it's one or the other. I think we have to do both.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Philippe?
I like the leapfrogging. In fact, it's the name of a company called Leapfrog. And they're working in Africa, and they're coming up with extremely creative solutions. So the key is how to use all this innovation and adapt them in emerging market. But you will be surprised, even in the poorest places, and it goes everywhere. Education. I was in Bhutan. Bhutan is Himalaya, so it's very hard to cater to schools in rural country, mountainous country, very complicated. But they developed a kind of the e-education, where you can reach across the country. You know, I did a math class with the prime minister, and we reached the class on the other side of the country. So, and this is starting to be introduced in Colombia. Minuto is using a big chunk of their delivery mechanism thanks to new IT. I mean, in Africa, you'll be surprised. You have talking about, we saw a beggar in the street in one of the poorest African country. He wanted to give some omon. Why? He said, well, give me through the iPhone. I mean, you see now drones being used to go to very remote areas to get some blood sample, bring the blood samples back to the hospital, get the analysis, send the drugs back. I mean, so the imagination now it's taking over. So the limit is the imagination, how you can recombine these new technologies, because it's all about combination and recombination materials. We don't talk about it because IT is maybe more spectacular or something, but materials, there's a revolution there too. So energy efficiency, I think we'll see huge improvement.
And you know, the best way to cut energy cost is making it more efficient. So for me, the use is limitless, only the imagination. But, and that's the but I want to put on the table, I know there's a big debate. We're going to skip the third revolution and go straight to the fourth revolution. And maybe, and I will not pronounce myself on that, but I know one thing, that in Bhutan, it would not have been possible to do this kind of e-learning if you don't have broadband. That's infrastructure. At the end, you come to something very hard. You need the roads, you need the water, you need the clean water. You can use new technology to improve the efficiency of water treatment, etc. But at the end of the day, you have to have this base on which a platform of infrastructure, on which you, then you can you can base and use and reuse and recombine all these new technologies. So that's, again, I'm very consistent, as you can see, on infrastructure.
We have the two big countries in the region for different reasons, Brazil and Mexico, in trouble right now. So, Ricardo, you have been invited to be president of Brazil. Let's take this scenario, president of Brazil. And can you answer what you would do in this case?
The question was about industrial policy. Yeah. I mean, I was aspiring to become emperor of the galaxy, but I have to settle for Brazil. Let me start by, connecting what would you do with industrial policy with the previous discussion. I think that, what you can say about the fourth industrial revolution is the same thing you could say about the Holy Roman Empire. It's neither the fourth, nor is it industrial, nor is it the revolution. Right? So, because what you need to reinvent and reconsider in the possibilities of leapfrogging is, say you have Uber, right? Before Uber, you needed to know how to drive, where to drive, what are the tricks of the city. Now Uber knows more than an experienced taxi driver. They used to take, 3 years to graduate in London to become a taxi driver. That's an example of leapfrogging. You don't need as much know-how as you needed before to do that. All the technologies that are being considered thought for education about moving things to the tablet and providing more feedback to the student, to the teacher about progress and so on, that is an example where you sort of like leapfrog from having just excellent teachers to a system that can provide more education with more regular teachers. What is being done here in agriculture in Argentina, of having precision agriculture.
No-till
agriculture, but no, precision agriculture with the satellites that tell you meter by meter how much fertilizer you need to put in and so on, and make it available as a software to all farmers across the country. The possibilities of 3D printing, of having a lot of solutions and stuff done locally in communities and so on. So this suggests that the application areas are well beyond manufacturing into the holes of society. And to harness them, this is what I like to call a high bandwidth problem. This is an information intensive problem. So the way I think we should think about quote unquote industrial policy, now the IDB suggests that we call it productive development policies, is that the fundamental role of these policies is to reveal information of where are the opportunities and where are the obstacles. So it's a mechanism to reveal information about opportunities, obstacles, and to come up with an action plan. And we have identified here action plans in several areas, and we need more of them, because the possibilities are so disseminated throughout all the activities that we need to bring them to the fore. And to do that, you need to have a dialogue process with society. Now, the problem, Wittgenstein said that all problems in philosophy are problems in language, and we are trapped by the wrong language. When people say private-public dialogue, we sort of understand what they mean by public. But the question is, what do they mean by private? And by private, everybody thinks it's sort of like businessmen, empresarios in Spanish. And that is, right, the wrong way to put it. Because if you're talking about a major corporation, say like Dow, what is Dow? Is Dow a group of shareholders that own the company? Or is DAO the CEO of the company? Or is DAO really, you know, all the workers of the company, the suppliers of the company, the customers of the company, the neighbors of the company, the service providers of the company? So is DAO sort of like that stakeholder ecosystem? That when they sit down, they're thinking about that stakeholder ecosystem, right? And that's what you represent. When you represent your company, you represent your stakeholders. So when you sit at the table, you're thinking about how do I increase the productivity of my stakeholders? How can I make it win-win? But because if it is a question of just the owners of the capital that want to get a higher return for the money, then first of all, why do you want a seat at the table? You know, democracy involves, you know, other people also having a seat at the table. And why should you getting a higher return for your money preempt other people having other things in society? So what's the legitimacy of this conversation? Or, for example, in the case of Argentina, you say, well, if you have to have the entrepreneur, the businessman at the table, you need labor at the table. But I thought that labor was part of DAO. Right? Labor was part of the ecosystem. So now it's supposedly, instead of like integrating that ecosystem and representing it, it's being split off in between capital and labor and having a discussion there that makes no sense in terms of exploiting those synergies. So I think that we need to change what we call dialogue. We need to change what we call dialogue. We need to make it legitimate vis-a-vis of society. Like Christina Kirchner would never sit down with the enemy, right, with the private sector. So we need to make it legitimate vis-a-vis society, and we should have a mechanism so that when ideas are presented, they can be argued in terms of the public interest, they can be monitored and implemented.
Okay, extremely rich discussion. We have plenty of ideas, plenty of positive outcomes. The need of the fourth industrial revolution as an enabler to leapfrog, the great human capital that is in the region. And then you are calling for a 2G free trade. I don't know if it's 4G. The need for a free trade that needs to be revised, a 2G free trade. And last but not least, the need for a dialogue. And that's why we are all here. And the World Economic Forum provides this dialogue. So thank you all. Please join me in thanking the panel members in this very rich discussion.